Good morning and welcome to the 39th meeting of the Health, Social Care and Sport Committee in 2023. I've received apologies today from Ivan McKee and David Torrance. The first item on our agenda is to decide whether to take items 5 and 6 in private. Are members agreed? Thank you. Second item on our agenda is a fifth oral evidence session as part of the committee's inquiry into healthcare in remote and rural areas. Today we will be hearing from representatives of health professional associations. For this morning's session, I welcome to the meeting Dr Ian Kennedy, Chair of BMA Scotland, Julie Mosgrove, Chair of Optometry Scotland, who joins us remotely, Vary Templeton, Society of British Dental Nurses, and Laura Wilson, Director for Scotland of the Royal Pharmaceutical Society. And we'll move straight to questions in Sandesh Gohani.
Thank you very much, convener. Just to declare my interest as a practising NHS GP, but also as a BMA member, given that Dr Kennedy is here. Can I start with you, Ian, if I may? I'm rather concerned about the potential for a two-tier health service, given issues with recruiting and the issues that we have generally, but specifically when it comes to physicians' associates. So I saw a job advert advertised in Ravenmore where the physician's associate will actively undertake clinical supervision of ward nursing staff, junior doctors and student PAs to facilitate the development of clinical skills and practice. NHS Highland followed up by saying this was an error and it's a GMC-recognised role. Now, given that PAs will be regulated by the GMC, are we going to see a position where we have increasing numbers of PAs across potentially rural areas and they're going to be supervising doctors?
So I saw that advert when it came out at the weekend and I was concerned about the advert for PAs and the fact that a PA who perhaps has 2 years training after a science degree would be supervising doctors who may have had 10 years training. So I wasn't too surprised yesterday when I saw the Twitter storm from many of my members across Scotland on that. I have personally spoken to a senior executive in NHS Highland and they have told me that that is an error. And NHS Highland has also come out on Twitter saying that it was an error. The BMA in Scotland is concerned about physician associates and anaesthesia associates. We've made representation to the Cabinet Secretary on that. We would prefer if they were called assistants and not associates because they're not of the profession, they're not doctors, and we know that patients are confused and that they think they are seeing doctors. We have also asked the Cabinet Secretary whether he would consider another regulator other than the General Medical Council, which was, of course, set up so that we could ensure that patients were seeing doctors. So I share your concerns about PAs. And on your general question about a two-tier service, I've said many times that I think we have a three-tier service. We have those in Scotland that can afford to pay for private healthcare. We have those who are perhaps the more fitter, less frail patients who are getting services from areas such as the National Treatment Centre, and we've got our older, generally frailer patients who are languishing on NHS waiting lists. So yes, BMA Scotland, we have been speaking up over a number of years about widening inequalities, and yes, we are sleepwalking into at least a two-tier service, and I would argue a three-tier service.
And so on that, specifically trying to address rural areas, because I do think there's a distinct difference between our urban belt and our rural belt. The GP contract that has centralised provisions, things like vaccinations, has that been a success in our rural Highland areas? And also, was the government warned in advance of the contract coming in that it could cause a problem specifically to our rural and island population?
So I should declare, obviously I'm here representing BMA Scotland, I'm the chair of BMA Scotland, but I think it's well known in Scotland that I led the no vote on the GP contract in Scotland when I was the medical director of Highland Local Medical Committee. So my views on the GP contract of 2018 are very well known, and yes, the government was advised at that time and I advised them. on behalf of my colleagues who made very strong representation. The 2018 contract across Scotland has been only partially implemented. So, sadly, it hasn't been a success anywhere in Scotland. Listening to my rural members across Scotland, they remain deeply unhappy about the outcome of that contract because of the way that it distributed resources and arguably made inequalities worse, not only in rural areas but in deprived areas. But there is one potential solution which my GP chair, Dr. Andrew Buist, is pushing the government to implement, and that is phase two, which would help address the excess costs of delivering health in rural areas, excess staff costs. And phase two, the aim of that is to help pay GP practices for their staff expenses and their non-staff expenses, which are much greater in rural areas because of the excess cost of supply.
Thank you. Certainly, we'll be coming on to recruitment, so I won't venture into questions about that. Could I ask about optometry, please? We've got some fantastic examples in Lanarkshire, in Glasgow, of people being able to go directly to their opticians and get help with their eyes directly from them and be referred to the hospital and then pick up the prescriptions and have this wonderful dialogue but not come to GP because, quite frankly, they're better at eyes than I am. So why is this not something that's rolled out across the country, and what are the barriers that we're seeing for that to happen?
It's been funding. So there's been a shared care kind of rollout of glaucoma and the glaucoma scheme across Scotland. So that's allowed us to see glaucoma patients within low-risk glaucoma patients within community eye care practices. For the anterior eye, the front of the eye, there are pockets at the Eye Health Network in Grampian, like you mentioned, and also in Lanarkshire. And at the moment, it's funding. So it is something that we have spoken with government, and there is, in the background, we have developed pathways to be able to do that, but it's been held up with funding at the moment. So that would allow us to see certain conditions within community eye care practices across Scotland.
Thank you. And my final question to Laura, if I may. Specifically looking at our rural population, Pharmacy First, I think, is a great initiative. It allows people to go and get help very quickly when they need it with somebody who is skilled and does know what they're doing. And it's really important to stress that they are trained to do that. But are there enough pharmacists in rural areas, and is there enough time for them to be able to do this fantastic work, or is there a slight difference between what we see in the urban areas and what we see in rural areas?
So yeah, there definitely is a variation in the number of pharmacists that are available in remote and rural areas, as there will be with GPs or optometrists or anybody. I think for the provision of the Pharmacy First service, there's probably a number of issues that arise. So things like access to training. So for a one-day training session for a pharmacist from a remote and rural area might require 2 days travel for them. So that access is very centrally located. And I think it's important that we recognise the impact that it has on people to actually even access those things. So I think, you know, what would be helpful for us would be support for those pharmacists to actually undertake that training closer to home to be able to provide those services. Once they've qualified and they're providing those services, ongoing support would be good, because obviously they can be isolated and you know, we want them to kind of flourish in those roles and provide them. And I think it's about trying to identify where the pockets are, where those services are needed, and gathering data that would allow us to actually see where the services are provided, where they're not provided, target those people and offer them the support to undertake the training to then provide those services. I know it was one of the themes as well, but to try and expand on those services and allow the kind of, to allow them to be used to their fullest, obviously access to records would be something that would be massively helpful, and that would then allow us to continue to provide those services and expand them as appropriate for remote and rural communities and the population as a whole.
Thank you.
No problem. Carol Morgan.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning. I think it probably leads on the question I have from what Laura was talking about. It's about the models of training for staff in the NHS, and we have a very university-based style for a lot of the professions across the NHS. So we've heard quite a lot of evidence about that and about how we encourage people in remote areas to train and stay perhaps in their own area to build a workforce that cares a lot about that community. So I would be interested for each of the panels, if they maybe could say for their profession and the wider NHS, how they think we could, what models we could use or what the universities could do to perhaps get the balance more right for people.
So I think certainly for pharmacy, it's a very university orientated course. It's a science degree at the moment. It's not a health degree. So I think it's important that there is that university input. I think it's provided by two universities in Scotland, one in Aberdeen and one in Glasgow. So people from remote and rural communities don't necessarily see pharmacy as an option for them because they have to leave home to study it. Once they've been supported to do that, and there's different models that are used that have been trialled, one in the Highlands where they almost sponsored somebody to kind of attend university but then paid for their travel to go back and forth so that they were maintaining those links to the community. But obviously that's a high cost burden for one person, and with no guarantee at the end that they're actually going to go back and stay in the remote and rural community. So they were trying, but that cost can't be borne for many students, obviously. So if we do get them to go to university and become pharmacists, it's about how we, whilst at university, we still maintain those links with remote and rural communities and allow them the experiential learning there, and make sure that they're getting the experience, because if you've never experienced it, you don't know whether you like it or you don't. And then once they've qualified, it's about how we encourage them to go back to those areas and actually take up places that are available, and how we support them to do that. I think.
Sorry for interrupting. I just wondered if you had any good examples of where that had happened, or is it still something that needs to happen?
I think it's something that we need to look at, different models of education that could be provided. Okay. So whether that's supported, travel to and from universities, or a completely different model, which maintains the sort of structure of the university course and the integrity of that, but allows that remote and rural connection to be maintained as well. I think it is important, and it was something we would support being looked at.
Thank you. Mary, I don't know if you have any examples or...
Unfortunately, just due to timescales, I haven't been able to gather the information that I need to deliver today. But it's interesting to hear all the feedback, and I would be willing to take that back to the board and try and feedback back it next time.
Okay, great. Thank you. Optometry, do we have any good examples of where it's maybe working there?
Up until 2 years ago, the only university in Scotland was Glasgow Caledonian University, whereas the University of Highlands and Islands have just started an optometry course within the last kind of 2 years, with the hope that students will graduate and stay within the kind of Highland Health Board and also raise awareness of the profession within the area. It's more a blended programme, so students will be coming out into community eye care practices, which is something that's not happened before. But in the UK, generally, optometry as a course has been completely overhauled. So that will change over the next kind of 2 years. And they're going to be in Scotland. The idea is to embed independent prescribing. So optometrists will come out qualified and be able to prescribe medication as well. And that will be a blended course through both universities. At the moment, it's unclear how these placements will be supported and how that'll look from a funding point of view. But that is all going to change within the next couple of years.
Lovely. Thank you. Just, Dr. Kennedy, if you don't mind, that sort of general point for medicine as well. But I'm also interested to know that there has been additional medical training places for medics. And I just wondered, in terms of remote and rural, was that embedded in the process of working out what we needed with the medical training?
OK, so a couple of quick conflicts of interest that I should declare. Born and bred in Inverness, wife, lecturer, University, Highlands and Islands. We don't, of course, have a university in the north of Scotland. We've got five medical schools, which drains people away, including myself, who trained in Edinburgh. What we know is that people are more likely to work in a rural area if they are born and bred there. I'm an example. I didn't plan to go back to a rural area. It happened. So we need to grow our own. We need to recruit people from the rural areas of Scotland, and we need to get involved with them when they are school pupils, for example, getting them into care homes. It's good culturally to get intergenerational interactions, so it'd be good to get exposure to school pupils at a young age. We also need to actively recruit from remote and rural areas. I think you were perhaps alluding to an apprenticeship training model. The BME doesn't support that, although there are some pilots in parts of England that might be worth watching in the years ahead. And in terms of your specific question around the 200 extra medical students, I was in discussion with a senior doctor last night, and we were talking about how we haven't actually managed to fill those places. For some reason, school pupils in Scotland are not choosing to go into medicine. They're choosing engineering, they're choosing science degrees, and we need to ask ourselves why that is. Again, to give you a specific example, and this is actually not at undergraduate level, but the new Centre for Remote and Rural Healthcare, I'm doing a little bit of work with it at the moment, and there are three training hubs developing across Scotland in GP practices to train advanced nurse practitioners, advanced clinical pharmacists, and perhaps practice nurses, healthcare assistants. So there's one at my main practice in Inverness, there's another one in Stonehaven, and another one in Gala Shields. So that's kind of adopting the model of grow your own, train people where they're actually going to work.
Lovely, thank you. Thanks very much. Thanks, Convener.
Emma Harper.
Thanks. Convener. Thank you, Convener. Good morning to everybody. Before I go on to my theme, just a quick question for Dr. Kennedy about ScotGem, the graduate entry to medicine programme that has been uniquely created in Scotland to address rural healthcare needs, basically training people with a degree in some kind of healthcare degree already to then do this graduate entry to medicine. My understanding is it's been quite successful in Dumfries and Galloway. What's the perception of ScotGem in your world?
Yeah, so very positive perception of ScotGem within the BME in Scotland and across my colleagues. Another conflict of interest, my practice trained the first batch of ScotGem students in Inverness. I can remember groups of six students coming in. We had one of our GPs freed up for a full 2 days every week purely to train ScotGem students. These students, highly motivated, mature, brilliant. One concern is, do they actually come back and work in the rural areas? But yes, ScotGem is regarded as a success, and the bursary that these students get is something that I think we should try to emulate for undergraduate medical students at our universities so that they can be funded to go to the rural areas, which obviously attract much greater costs.
Mm-hmm. Okay, thank you. Okay, I'm interested in picking up issues around continuing professional development as well. So additional training. It is challenging to go for 2 days, Laura, as you said, travel to get to education. Is there a role for delivering more continuous professional development in rural areas directly, like the Clinical Skills Managed Education Network, yep, the Mobile Skills Unit for multi-professionals? Is that something that we could look at doing better?
Yeah, I mean, we would support any training that can be done more locally and that doesn't take pharmacists away from their practice for longer than is necessary, but allows them to build up those skills. I think as well encouraging you know, the pool of senior pharmacists who are there to then provide that peer review and that support is also far greater diluted in remote and rural areas, so trying to encourage them to take part in those things as well and provide them with some support and training to do that as well would be more than welcome.
And I probably need to declare an interest as well as a former clinical educator for nurses in remote and rural areas. Is there ways that more digital opportunities can be done so that for pharmacists in particular, online learning could be the way to deliver education?
Yeah, and pharmacists do a lot of online learning. I think for the clinical skills that Dr. Kennedy mentioned, you know, that hands-on is necessary, and how we provide that closer to home is vital. But I think, yeah, online learning is something that pharmacists do quite a lot of through NESS and other sort of organisations such as our own. They do provide learning online and they undertake that, which is really great because they can do it during their working day. They're not, you know, taken away.
And nothing beats hands-on clinical skills, like whether it's with simulated mannequins or whatever. Also, education budgets are often the first to get cut, so then clinical educators are then disposed of. So is there a way where potentially a standardised approach to certain clinical skills or methods of training so that same course could be delivered for different professionals? I know that pharmacists, dietitians, physiotherapists, GPs, everybody has completely, they have different roles, but is there an opportunity for some education to be standardised for multiple professionals?
Yeah, I mean, to a certain extent there is. Certainly when I did clinical skills, we learned how to, you know, ears, nose, eyes, chest, all those kind of things. I think we've got to make sure that they're going to use those clinical skills, because there's no point in training them if they're not going to use them, because they will lose them. I couldn't now listen to a chest, it's been too long. So I think the general approach would allow more people to be trained. I think we would need to evaluate whether or not it was worth training them in everything if it's not applicable to their practice. Mm-hmm. But they're always useful skills to have, and they certainly, you know, are well learned. It's just whether or not you're going to then keep up those skills and how you're going to ensure that competence going forward with those skills.
And is there enough time for education? I'm going to ask Dr. Kennedy as well, because some GP practices will close for half a day for continuing professional development for all of the staff in the area. Is there enough time in the day to do the education that's needed for continuing professional development?
So, unfortunately, protected learning time in general practice in Scotland has gone. That resource has been removed from NHS 24, so GPs no longer have that. And I was speaking to a hospital doctor who works in Skye last night, and he was appealing to me to ask for resource to be built into hospital doctors' contracts and GP contracts to provide continuing professional development in remote and rural areas, because these clinicians require a much greater range of skills than those in the city. It's a far greater breadth of skills, and they're not funded in any way to do that. And in terms of your remote online learning idea, I think a good example of that is basics training pre-hospital emergency care, where, yes, you absolutely do need to be in the room or in the field, and it's doctors, nurses, from across primary and secondary care, so multidisciplinary learning. But that, some of that can be done online as well, so there is a mixed approach there. But the rural doctors tell me, please do not have us remote consulting our patients, remote learning, remote everything. It's not the solution. You know, there's nothing like seeing the patient face-to-face and seeing your colleagues face-to-face.
OK, thank you. Thank you.
Scroll wanted to come in too.
OK, thanks.
Hi, it was just to add on to kind of what colleagues have been saying about kind of the training side of things. I think when you're working in a remote and rural area, it can be very isolating and difficult. And I think once you've qualified as well as having that ongoing support whilst you're living in these areas, and kind of working together with other healthcare professionals as well can help kind of learn from each other and support each other kind of in that. And I think one of my colleagues touched on it as well already, just about having face-to-face kind of placements available in hospitals in rural locations to be able to upskill professionals kind of working there as well.
Thanks.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you. Ruth Maguire.
Thank you, convener. Good morning, panel. Thanks for being with us. I'd like to ask about multidisciplinary teamwork. It would be helpful to for the committee to understand how well multidisciplinary team working is being implemented. If you had some examples of where it had worked well, perhaps examples where there had been challenges, that would be helpful for us in understanding. Laura, you're nodding, so I'll come to you first. If that's
I think you know, the pharmacotherapy service that Dr. Kennedy alluded to, there's definitely good examples of where pharmacists have become embedded in the multidisciplinary team and pharmacy technicians as well. We had a fantastic example of a pharmacist and a pharmacy technician who, along with the patient's usual prescriber, had actually reduced the patient from being on something like 6 or 7 medicines. He was housebound. He was, you know, unable to take part in anything socially. He is now appearing as Santa at one of the local children's hospitals after having undergone a polypharmacy review, which started with the pharmacy technician, who then referred them to the pharmacist for ongoing support and consideration of medicines. And along with their usual prescriber within the practice, they were able to like completely change his life.
And did that happen because you were located in the same place, or because of a sort of different structural way
of working?
I think
it was well-defined roles, a good skill mix, an understanding of the roles of each member of the team and how they were going to interact, and they worked well together to provide that, each one knowing their limitations and being able to you know, call on support and help from the you know somebody else within that team to come to a collective effort.
And were they literally in the same building, or were
so they
part
were
of a
for
sort of virtual team?
Majority of the time, but the pharmacy technician covered 2 sites. The pharmacist worked for that one practice, and obviously the GP prescriber was in that practice as well. So not always physically together, but more time spent than has been in the past.
Okay, that's helpful. Ian Kennedy, do you have any?
Yeah, so multidisciplinary teams. If you say MDT, as I'm going to do, that's much easier. So quite a lot to say about MDTs. Crucial in remote and rural areas. You know, sharing a common purpose, good relationships. That's what makes good teams in remote and rural areas. They tell me that it's sometimes okay to recruit these MDTs, but difficult to retain them because of issues with housing, issues with childcare, and issues with schooling. We were talking about the GP contract 2018 earlier. The whole idea of that contract was to deliver MDTs to GP practices across Scotland. That has not been implemented, and it did not work well for rural areas because simply the resources did not provide the numbers of MDT staff that were required. So we have lots of practices in the Highland that have very few pharmacists and mental health nurses, physios, these additional roles. In terms of good examples, again, I'll use my own practice in Inverness, not quite rural, but a lot of people in Scotland.
I was going to ask you about that because you described Inverness as rural earlier, and I thought,
Yeah, it's not really, but yeah. If I can use my own practice, we've got 4 practices, and 2 of them are rural. So we have a hub and a training hub that will train the MDT, and then they go out to Cromarty, to Foyers. So these training hubs that I mentioned earlier, one in Stonehaven, one in Gala Shields, the whole purpose of these training hubs, and NHS Education Scotland is very much behind this, is to build up multidisciplinary teams within the workplace. So I think that is the way ahead, and specifically in rural areas, we do need to incentivise MDTs, not just doctors, but the whole MD sure. team to go out there and live and work there. And that might require, for example, 20% added to their pay to
sure.
get those people in and so that they'll stay.
Okay, I will come back and talk about housing and sort of different structural stuff. We had some feedback from Derek Laidler from the Chartered Society of Physiotherapy. I can't remember if it was last week or the week before. He spoke to the committee about the challenges of being located within GPs' practices and reported that there was some pushback from GPs in terms of hosting people physically within their premises. Can you tell us a bit more about what your members say, you know, why that might be or what the difficulties are?
Yeah, it's very much about space. It's about rooms. And if you don't have enough rooms, there's an opportunity cost to having a physio or a mental health nurse when a GP might need that room. So sadly, maybe over the past two decades, we have invested very little in primary care premises. The focus has been on hospitals, as in most Western countries, not unique to Scotland. But the quality of the estate in primary care in Scotland has gone down. And you know, the GPs of Scotland simply do not have the necessary rooms to accommodate these MD teams. I'm lucky. I've got a recently extended practice, so I can fit these people in. But many of our smaller rural practices, they struggle with the space.
So I represent a constituency in Ayrshire, and I have an example of, and it's within an urban setting, of a GP practice co-locating essentially within a community centre, within a community hub. They're not there all the time, but they go in and out. Is that a model that could work in rural areas, do you think, for multidisciplinary teams?
So I'm thinking about, I've probably worked on about 30 rural practices in Scotland, and I'm trying to picture all the village halls, and some of them were quite close to the practice, but I'm not really visualising that sort of accommodation. I don't think
so. So this was a new build sort of thing.
Yeah.
So I mean, is there opportunity for, when we look at renewing facilities within communities, looking at wider needs?
Yeah, absolutely. That model that you describe sounds very attractive, and certainly increased accommodation and co-working with the community, I think, is the way forward.
Okay, thank you. I don't know, Maddie, if you have anything you wish to
not
add.
Specifically, I would need to go back and feedback in to
okay.
try and get more answers.
Thank you. And Julie Mosgrove, I don't know if she wishes to come in on multidisciplinary teams at all.
No, nothing specific for me.
Do you want me to leave the next one and come back?
If you're all right, Matt, of course. We've got us up from Sandesh Gohani.
Thank you, convener. A couple of very quick ones. So I recently worked in NHS Fife. And Dr. Kennedy, MDT doesn't just include our physios and pharmacists and others, but it also includes people who work in schools, for example. So in NHS Fife, you cannot give children in schools basic medication like Calpol unless the GP has prescribed it. How is that helping our primary care?
So I have to say that I haven't come across that personally, nor have I heard members mentioning it recently, although it has been a feature in the past. But I think most GPs in Scotland would push back if they were asked to do that. So I'd be concerned about that, and it's certainly something that the BMA in Scotland would be willing to take up further if you were to give us more details.
Well, it was the Fife LMC that was saying that this was the case, and they've been struggling for a year now to get schools to change their mind. But the second question, and moving on, again on NHS Fife, so working in primary care, we want to try and keep people out of hospitals. I mean, I'd love to do it as much as possible. So being able to order some pretty routine tests like BNP for a heart failure is not something we're able to do in primary care and NHS Fife. Now, why are there such differences over the piece? Because there are some basic things that we can do, and I don't understand why you can say it's not acceptable for someone who's trained to order an examination that will, in essence, keep someone out of hospital.
Yeah, so certainly in my own area in Highland, BNP, which, as you know, is a test for heart failure that we can do in the community, you can do that in my practice in Highland. So I'm not sure why it's not possible to do that in Fife. And yes, we want to minimise that sort of variation. Fife was relatively well resourced out of the GP contract compared to remote and rural areas, but it's one of the areas in Scotland that is really struggling to recruit GPs, so there are particular pressures on Fife, that's for sure.
Thank you.
Emma Harper.
Thanks. Thanks, Convener. It's just a quick question for Dr Kennedy about NRAC formula. I was at NHS Borders update on Friday, and Rafe Roberts was talking about, he's the chief exec, he was talking about the NRAC formula and how it works as far as funding for remote and rural areas as well. Can you tell us about the NRAC formula and whether you think it needs revised or altered in any way?
So none of these formulas are perfect, including NRAC. Again, for the GP contract, it was the Scottish Workforce Allocation Formula, and that certainly had its flaws. So I think we do need to look at these formulae, and we need to look at the data as it is now. We know that in remote and rural areas, we attract the older patients in the population. They tend to go out to the rural areas. So there's much greater frailty and all the comorbidities that go with age. So these formulas need to be rural-proof. None of them are. They tend to be suited for urban areas. And one of my colleagues from Grampian often talks about geographical narcissism and urban splaining, which are international academic terms that describe how people in cities tell people in rural areas what's good for them. So we've got to stop doing that, and we've really got to dig deep into the data in remote and rural areas and make sure that formulas are fit for purpose, or that there is some kind of adjustment made once the formula is applied.
Okay, thanks.
Gillian Mackay.
Thanks, Convener, and good morning to the panel. What benefits could be realised in remote and rural areas from having improved sharing of IT systems like electronic prescribing and single patient records and more joined up access to patient information? And I'll maybe come to Laura first.
We've long advocated for access to patient data, particularly for community pharmacists, and I think as we mentioned earlier, the things like Pharmacy First Plus and Pharmacy First, we could expand those services and create that far greater equity of access to treatments that would be available in the community rather than having to identify them, and patients, particularly in remote rural areas, then having to travel large distances to their GP to get the treatment that would be appropriate for a pharmacist to provide. Single shared patient data would be transformative for the whole of community pharmacy, but particularly in remote and rural areas, it would prevent a lot of unnecessary travel for patients and allow them to access that care closer to home.
That's great, thank you. Just come down the line.
Nothing. No, thank you.
Grand. Dr. Kennedy.
Yeah, so an electronic patient record, reasonable in primary care in Scotland, although our systems are quite out of date and need updated, but in secondary care in hospitals there isn't an electronic patient record. Mm-hmm. And that would be a huge improvement, particularly for clinical governance and for learning. So that's a big gap. I think in England they use System 1, mm-hmm. Which is very successful, but I understand that we can't afford it in Scotland. But an electronic patient record, it's a must. We should have had it decades ago, and it would certainly improve patient safety, it would improve the patient journey, and absolutely improve clinical governance.
Okay. I don't know if colleagues online have got any thoughts?
Probably just to reiterate what the panel said already, it's to get a lot of information. If we're prescribing medication to patients, understanding what general health conditions they actually have, what medications they have. It's been able to understand kind of complications from things, and also, like colleagues said already, about safety and time as well, the amount of time it takes to get the information that's holding up the kind of process for the patient as well, and the clinician as well. So it's to improve patient journey and kind of safety and governance as well.
That's great, thank you. Are there any specific data gaps in the information available in relation to rural health services? If so, what are they? How do we make them better? And what impact does this have on service planning? And I'll maybe go to Dr. Kennedy first this time.
Yeah, there's huge data gaps, and it's probably one of our biggest infrastructure problems in Scotland, the lack of data. And we need data on our patients, what their comorbidities are, what their health needs are. We need to do proper needs assessments for our remote and rural populations. But we also have an absence of data on workforce, because the ageing demographic isn't just affecting patients, it's affecting the workforce as well, generally over 50. So we have huge, huge gaps in data.
Laura's nodding, so I'm going to come to Laura next.
Yeah, I think certainly for pharmacy, we need data on where our students come from, where they go back to. We need to know where the gaps are so that we can actually try and plug those gaps and find solutions to do that. We don't have workforce planning for pharmacy like we do for medics and nurses, so we don't know what the gaps are. And if we don't know what the gaps are, we're struggling to then get the right number of people in the right places. And I think, you know, we train hundreds of pharmacists every year, and there was a commitment in the workforce plan to provide additional funding to train those pharmacists, but we're still short by about 70 places. So that's 70 people that we train in Scotland who get experience in remote and rural areas, who get that chance to go and see that, who then leave to go to more than likely England or Wales to practice and get their foundation year. So for us, we need the basic data on workforce, and we need the patient data to be accessible.
Great. Julie?
Very much the same kind of challenges. Definitely a lack of information on workforce, kind of work patterns, behaviour, and planning for the future, kind of the students that are coming through and knowing what optometrists we need across Scotland, and also patient information. I think there's a lot of information out there and there's a lot of different systems being used, but they don't all talk to each other as well. So although there is information, it's not easily shared between different professions.
Thanks, Convener.
Can I just come back to Dr. Kennedy and something? I might have misheard you when you were talking about electronic patient records, but the ZMIS system.
So EMIS is one of the systems that's used in primary care in Scotland. INPS Vision is the more commonly used one, but EMIS is purely in general practice, not in
No,
hospital.
It's not. And I declare an interest here as a registered mental health nurse, and I was using it on Friday in a community addiction team. So it is used in other parts of the NHS. And I'm pretty sure it's used in mental health inpatient services as well.
Okay, thanks for educating me. It's a system that's not used in the Highlands, so I'm not familiar with it in that context. So
I just wanted to clarify that. Yeah. Paul Sweeney.
Thank you, Convener. Dr. Kennedy, you mentioned the system one in England. Of course, the constraints there you describe as financial. I've been in contact with GPs, certainly in my area in Glasgow, who describe the fact that any sort of improvement to services or deployment of new technology is constrained by sheer capacity to actually take the practice offline to deliver any new system or to train staff. Is that a constraint that you would see as being an issue in rural settings as well?
Yes, absolutely. In my career, I can probably remember two IT changes, and it's hectic and chaotic and stressful. In terms of putting the software and the infrastructure in, often it's done at the weekends, so if that can be done, that always helps. But in terms of actually learning a new system, that's something that practices in Scotland, and I'm sure hospitals too, could do with a lot of support the next time a major change happens.
Mm. What kind of support would be practical and useful in that? And, you know, it might be hard to describe exactly, but you know, what type of additional resource could be supplied by health boards or by the government directly?
Yes, I suppose it's all the things that would happen with any change management project. You know, IT systems tend to land on your desk, literally, on the day. and you get on with it. And we don't introduce changes like that for anything else we do. We would normally have preparation and planning and support throughout, and that's that ongoing support, you know, people either physically in the building or quickly accessible online to help when the glitches occur. But yeah, it's an area that we need to invest in.
Okay, is there any supplementary points on that at all?
Sorry, I was just going to say, yeah, pharmacy systems can change, but obviously in the community they're usually the change is usually implemented by the contractor, and just as Dr. Kennedy was saying, there's usually support provided to do that. But if planned for, it's usually manageable, I would say. And if it's for the better, then, you know, it's something that teams will work through.
Do you feel it's something that is a feedback loop whereby practitioners are describing a problem and a solution is developed and co-designed with practitioners, or is it something that's kind of dumped on you and you just have to deal with the adaption?
I think it's probably different for community pharmacy because the independent contractor will decide themselves what system to use and implement that. So I think it's usually a conscious decision to go with a different system, and they then obviously undertake that change themselves. So it's not usually a block change as such.
Does that then introduce problems in terms of interaction with other healthcare services, if there's that sort of fragmentation?
There is no interaction with community pharmacy systems and other healthcare systems and other healthcare IT systems.
And that in future, if there were to be that desire to integrate, would be challenging because of that?
Yeah, I think that is one of the challenges, is the interoperability of the systems and the variety of systems that are out there.
Okay, thanks.
I'm going to move to Tess White, who's joining us remotely. No, we can't hear you.
Thank
Tess.
You, convener.
We can't.
Dr. Kennedy, you raised an issue about closure of care homes, and you gave you said the closure of care homes and ongoing recruitment struggles in the care sector have created a crisis. You gave the example of Broadford Hospital, who are left in limbo in Aberdeenshire. Closure of smaller care homes does cause, in rural areas, does cause a huge issue on delayed discharges. I just wonder if you could say a bit more about that, please.
So the quote that you're giving there, I'm trying to recall, it's perhaps something that's gone out via BMA Scotland in advance of today. And certainly I'm aware of care homes closing across Scotland. And it's a huge concern, as is the whole of social care. Recently, at the Scottish GP conference, the Cabinet Secretary mentioned his vision of having the patient first, then social care, then primary care, then secondary care, and that's a good model. And you know, obviously, care homes are very much part of social care. So it hugely concerns me, given the ageing population, when I hear about care homes closing across Scotland, and of course, it's an issue in rural areas. I mentioned one of my practices, Cromarty, earlier. The one and only care home in Cromarty closed last year.
Thank you. In relation to the location of clinics, could you talk about this huge balance between making sure that you've got the economies of scale for the high population areas, but could you talk about how you actually address that balance between the economies of scale for centralisation and then trying to deliver for the rural areas?
Yes, yeah, so of course, Scotland, we have a completely unique geography with a very dispersed population and not enough hospital consultants to work in all those areas. So we have some decisions to make. Do these consultants travel out to Orkney, Shetland, Isle of Skye, Fort William, wherever, do they travel out and therefore have 30% of their paid time on the road not seeing patients? Or do we have them working in the centres but seeing patients remotely on near me or by telephone? And at the moment, we've probably got a mix. And I think some patients really appreciate remote consulting and avoiding those 100-mile journeys to see the specialists. But there are also huge concerns from within primary care that patients are often being seen on the screen by the consultant and then being told to go and see the GP because they need a particular examination done or because there's something being picked up that needs addressed on that day. But it's inevitable that we need to provide a variety of methods, including face-to-face clinics, but also using technology as well.
Thank you. Convener, would you like me to go on to demographic challenges?
I've got a quick supplementary and then I'll come back to you, Tess, if that's okay. And it's specifically for Vari. And I suppose I'm keen to hear about some of the issues in dental health. And we've heard a lot in other sessions about the impact of travel time to access services and so on. So I'd be keen to hear what you think is the impact of travel time on people accessing dental health services in remote and rural areas and what impact that may have on health inequalities.
One thing I can say is we don't have any consultants down at the BGH for orthodontics. So there's a group of us that are travelling down on weekends to do the clinics on Saturdays and Sundays because we just don't have the BGH Border General Hospital consultant. So we're taking time out of our personal lives to travel down to try and get through all the clinics. And we are doing a good job of trying to get through, but we don't know when the consultant's going to be starting to continue on that care. Working within NHS Borders prior to coming to NHS Lothian, you had a great area to travel to get to Kelso Coldstream, Galashiels, and you were spending a lot of time personally to get to these clinics, so the patients would be having to travel as well. And also if they were coming up with emergency appointments and you had to offer them to travel to Eyemouth, to a general practitioner to get seen, and they were coming from, say, Hoyk or Peebles, they were spending all day to travel to get to that appointment, and some of them didn't drive. They had to access then buses, trains, taxis, and some of them just couldn't afford to do so. So I think that is the... I don't know if it's as easy as getting some more dentists down to rural areas such as the Borders.
Do you think that that has an impact then on existing health inequalities in terms of
for dentistry?
Health?
I think yes, because we can't get the NHS patients seen within our PDS and GDP practices.
I'll move back to Tess White.
Thank you, Convener. Dr. Kennedy, we know that patient numbers in remote and rural areas can change significantly. We've got a quote from the RPS that said when cruise ships come in to ports that they can go up as much as a third, and you're based in Inverness. I've got the example of Braemar. So my question is, how is the impact of tourism taken into account as part of funding and workforce planning? Thank you.
Yeah, so I think it's not really taken into account at all, and certainly Invergordon has, I think, 100 cruise ships a year, and of course places like the Isle of Skye, because of certain TV programmes, get lots of tourists from across the world, and it's very difficult to get moving in parts of Skye in the summer. And I know from when I did locums across rural areas, the summer months were extremely busy, and a lot of road traffic collisions. And of course, that's one of the things about rural areas. As a doctor and other healthcare professionals, you get involved in everything. It is scary work. And we know from research that's why a lot of city doctors don't go to the rural areas, because it is quite frightening. And the skill set that you require is massive. So, yes, the busiest times of the year in remote and rural areas are often the summer months with tourists. And these tourists, you know, whether they're coming from the cities across the UK or from abroad, they have no idea about the difficulty of providing healthcare in remote and rural areas. So they expect the same immediacy of service that they would be used to in their own area. So it's very demanding. And other than temporary resident provisions, I don't think we do much at all to take account of this excess numbers of patients and that fluctuation that occurs particularly in the summer months.
That's really helpful, thank you. And my second question is quite different, and it's looking at the ageing population. And you talked earlier about much greater frailty. So, and you know the example from the Highlands and Islands, and particularly Inverness, but I've got one example of, let's say, Aberdeenshire. Over the next 7 years, we've got an ageing population of around an increase of 28%. I mean, that's huge. The question is, how are steep increases like that going to be factored into budget, factoring, forecasting and workforce planning? Thank you.
So, Tess, Julie wanted to come in.
Sorry, just in relation to the last point and just talking about kind of tourist areas. So the other impact increase in tourism can have is on accommodation. And we're trying to get clinicians to get to areas. It can be very difficult for kind of getting accommodation kind of provided. It can be very expensive looking at hotels, B&Bs, and sometimes it can be just hard to actually get the clinician into the area in the remote and rural area.
Wow, thank you, Julie. I think it's good to hear you reinforce that. I mean, that's coming across loud and clear in this inquiry. So thank you for that. Okay, so if we can go on to the ageing population, Dr. Kennedy. As I say, I gave the example of 28%. That is whopping. Have you any thoughts on that, or is that just something that it's a crisis waiting to happen?
Yes, we knew this was going to happen, and we haven't prepared for it. And you mentioned Grampian, and my members in Grampian have been expressing serious concerns, particularly in general practice. And we, of course, we have a lot of rural GP practices in the Grampian area, but we also have concerns from doctors in the hospitals about vacancies there. And what the doctors in Grampian in primary care are calling for is direct investment in GP practices. There is resource there that hasn't been used to deliver the MDTs that were meant to have been provided by the GP contract, and the GPs in Grampian are pleading for that resource, and I think there's £10 million that should have come their way that hasn't. The GPs in Grampian are pleading for that resource to be directly invested in their GP practices, and it's by investing in primary care that we will help address the ageing population, because by the time the patients get into hospital, it's too late, and then we run into difficulties getting patients out of hospital because of our problems in social care. But of course, social care provision for an ageing population is probably more important than healthcare, and it's going to come down to resource. We've got to pay our social carers a decent wage. That might be £15 an hour, so that we get the social carers that we need to look after our frailer patients. But yeah, the ageing demographic, not just for our patients, but also for the workforce, is a huge concern to the BMA in Scotland.
Thank you. And if I can just, because you've covered a couple of themes there, if I can just drill down, one of the GPs and GP practices told me in Aberdeen was that they're having to hand money back because they can't recruit people into the multidisciplinary teams, but they do need the funding for GP to provide GP cover. So they were talking about an imbalance in terms of that formula that you described earlier. Do you think that the Scottish Government need to look again at that formula to make sure that it does address those needs that the GPs are saying?
Yes, as I said earlier, all formulae are flawed, and there's no doubt that the Scottish Workforce Allocation Formula was flawed. And what you're describing there about the inability to provide the MDT team is what I was alluding to. And those GPs who are appealing to you are obviously having to do that work that would have been done by these MDT teams, but they're not being given the resource. So the resource is there, but we need to rethink and maybe move on that issue so that we can provide greater healthcare provision in general practices in areas like Grampian.
Thank you. And just one final point. You used the phrase, forgive me, I hadn't heard that before, geographic narcissism. Just would you like to just say a couple of more words about that? Because that's quite a loaded term.
Yeah, so it was a new one for me as well on the 1st of December when I first heard it mentioned by Dr. Fenwick, who's the LMC Medical Director in Grampian. And she was speaking to all the GPs across Scotland, and it was quite a challenging statement to make, geographical narcissism, and it's often called urban narcissism. And you heard me mention urban splaining. So it's that situation where professionals, not just healthcare professionals, when they're speaking to rural professionals, say, well, when are you coming back to the city? As if going out to a rural area is something that you would do on a temporary basis. And certainly something that I've been aware of is people that have never worked in rural areas telling those of us who do work in rural areas how it should be done. So it's something that's known internationally. It's part of the human condition, geographical narcissism.
Thank you, Dr. Kennedy. Back to you, Convener.
Thank you. Ruth Maguire.
Thank you, Convener. I'd like to come back to... we were speaking about sustaining the MDTs and the sort of wider infrastructure challenges. We've heard quite a lot in this inquiry about housing specifically. Previous panels had given some examples where, for example, on the Isle of Bute, where there was nurses doing their training, there was sort of workarounds found with hotels or with colleagues providing digs, spare rooms. That's obviously not a long-term solution and not likely to attract qualified professionals. Ian Kennedy, I saw from that you were previously on the health board in NHS Highland. Are the health board and the local authority having conversations about what a whole system fix might look like, and are there any examples of perhaps more sustainable solutions to the issue of specifically housing? I suppose I'm thinking about, I know from the Isle of Skye that the college there provided land to a housing association, because obviously there's a shortage of housing, isn't just for medical staff, it's for, you know, across the board. So it was just to see if discussions were had, if you had any ideas for solutions.
Yeah, so I was a non-executive director of NHS Highland 2011 to 2014, so a wee while ago, but I have been speaking very recently to doctors in Skye, for example, and rural doctors across Scotland regarding housing. And the message that they're giving me is quite a clear one, and that is we need to invest in permanent healthcare staff. So that the housing problem is not a temporary issue of rent, but people can go in and buy a house. And that, to be absolutely clear, will require to pay these healthcare professionals, whether they are doctors or midwives or pharmacists or physios, pay them a decent wage so that they can afford to buy a house and live permanently in remote and rural areas.
Just to press back a little bit, I think some of the challenge we're hearing is about availability of housing. It's not necessarily, I would appreciate that affordability might be an issue for individuals as well, but this is about literal supply of housing within, and I suppose Skye would be an area I'd be familiar with, but that will be, you know, to varying degrees across the country in rural
areas. Yes, so availability is often cited, and Airbnb gets mentioned, and holiday homes as the reasons why those houses aren't available and unaffordable. But I have been asked to continually mention the importance of continuity. We know that the best outcome for patients is if they get continuity with a healthcare professional. That will do more for the health of patients in remote and rural Scotland than anything else, to see the same healthcare professional. And that the evidence is largely there for seeing the same GP. So we need continuity of care with the remote and rural GPs in Scotland, and that means attracting them in, resourcing them so that they can move in with their families and stay there for a generation.
Would you and your members feel that there is a place for health board, local authority, government to work together to provide that infrastructure, to provide the housing? Or solutions to how it gets built?
Yeah, again, I'm thinking personally about the times I've worked across remote and rural areas, and sometimes I would stay in health board accommodation next to a practice or even within a practice. And it's not the most attractive thing to mm-hmm. think of long term. So I suspect that health boards couldn't afford to do this and local authorities couldn't afford to do this. And even if they did, I don't think it's what's going to attract individual healthcare professionals to move there with their families on a long-term basis.
Okay, that's quite interesting. I suppose we're maybe thinking about different things. I'm wondering, I suppose, if I think about some health boards will have land that is not being used, and are there solutions for how they dispense with that land for not necessarily health accommodation, as you describe. I think that gives us a sort of image of a hostel type thing that perhaps wouldn't be attractive to permanent workers. Just to be clear, though, you didn't have those kind of whole system housing. Childcare wasn't mentioned in conversations with the board.
It was often mentioned. The issues that we're discussing today mm-hmm. have been discussed for decades.
Yes, but solutions to them? And the health board's part in getting to those solutions?
Yeah, the solutions are, you know, again, we're talking about similar solutions, but often it comes back to investment, comes back to investing in healthcare professionals and giving them the necessary resource to commit long-term to an area.
Okay, thank you. I don't know if anyone else has anything to add.
I was just going to say that, yeah, we've certainly heard from pharmacists more around the cost of things. Sunday, you know, was going to work in a remote and rural area, and the rent was somewhere between £800 to £1,000 for a month, so they declined to do that. So definitely those challenges are there. You know, we talk about London waiting and being, you know, that kind of thing to offset the cost of additional accommodation and the additional costs of accommodation. And I think from what we're being told, we're now seeing that in remote and rural areas, and that does, you know, as Dr. Mm-hmm. Kennedy said, that does force a challenge on everyone to try and address it.
Okay, thank you.
And Emma Harper.
Thanks, Convener. It's thinking about dentistry at Vary again and like remote and rural challenges. We've got an absolute crisis in Dumfries and Galloway for lack of dentists. Is there a role for dental nurses to step in at some level of supporting prevention? And I'm thinking about children especially. You know, if we have good oral hygiene for young people, I know Child Smile has been quite a success. But is there a role for dental nurses to help support our dental crisis?
Absolutely, yeah. We've got a lot of extended duty courses that we can put the dental nurses through, from radiography to impression taking, photography taking, that we can try and take the pressure off the dentists. These courses are pretty expensive. They usually sit around about £1,000. So can each person afford to pay that themselves, or do the NHS fund that for them? Not too sure. I know when I sat my radiography course, I self-funded that myself, because when I was in general practice, they couldn't afford to pay that for me. And being in the Dental Institute now, I'm not able to use my skill set as I would, because we've got our own radiographers from NHS Lothian that come in. So I feel that I do then lose my skill set in radiography. But we do certainly have a lot of extended duties that the dental nurses can carry on. But it's finding the time to put the nurses through that. It's a lot of it's on time, and do we have enough nurses to cover clinics with the dentists? But if we do have the trained nurses, then absolutely, I'm sure we can try and take the pressure off of any orthodontic need or general practice or public dental service.
I mean, and there's a range of like dental nurse locations where work is taking place. It could be in a NHS hospital, and you mentioned Borders General, and also in dental practices. Mm-hmm. So there is a wide range of opportunities that the skills can be implemented, right?
Yeah, I trained in general practice, leaving from school after sixth year. A lot of dental nurses do train after school, or they do it as a second career. Some of them go to follow up and doing dental therapy, oral health science, some of the universities across Scotland or down south.
Okay, thanks. Thanks.
Thank you. Can I thank the committee witnesses for attending today? And just for clarity, to put it on the record, declare my register of interest that I hold a bank nurse contract with Greater Glasgow and Clyde NHS. And we will briefly suspend while we change panels. The third item on our agenda is a session with the Scottish Football Association, and for this morning's session I welcome to the meeting Ian Maxwell, Chief Executive of Scottish Football Association, and we'll move straight to questions and Sandesh Gulhani.
Thank you. Thank you, Convener. And just to declare my register of interest as a former club doctor for Queen's Park. So I want to start with transparency, if I may. Now, look, all fans, regardless of who they support, think there's a conspiracy against their club. And that's just the way of it. But with the introduction of video-assisted referees with VAR, there does seem to be huge uncertainty with what's happening. So fans in the stadium don't know what's going on. When you're watching at home, you're never overly sure of what's happening, what counts, what doesn't count. And so, and obviously I've got to be very careful given that my party leader is a referee, but there just doesn't seem to be this transparency now in the game when it comes to decision-making and the way that the game is going for the average fan. Well, how would you respond to that?
I wouldn't agree it's a transparency point. I think there's an education point in terms of supporters being educated about VAR and how VAR works. VAR is still in its infancy in Scotland. You know, this is only the second season that we've had it. We, as the Scottish FA, sit on the board of IFAB, who are the International Football Association board and responsible for the laws of the game. And we had a meeting last month and talked about how we can improve the interaction between supporters in the stadium and supporters at home in terms of VAR and decisions that are made, because I fully appreciate there is nothing worse than sitting in a stadium being unaware of what's being checked or why it's being checked. Until recently, there has been no opportunity under the laws for any decisions to be broadcast in terms of within the stadium. That was recently trialled by FIFA at the Club World Cup, and match officials now, and the trial will be rolled out to any competition that wants to do so, they can now, they're linked up to the Tannoy system, to the PA, and they can now speak to what the decision that has been made has been and why it's been made, if you see what I mean. So the example would be if there was a check, if there was a change of decision because of a penalty, because of handball, they would come on and announce VAR check, penalty decision is because of handball, and that will give the supporters in the stadium more of an understanding of what's happening, because, listen, football's a spectator sport. The last thing you need is those that are in the stadium not knowing what's going on, and that uncertainty doesn't help anybody. So that it's more of a process point than actually, a transparency point.
But when you said actually this is an education point, when you've got in England, you can see the decisions being discussed with a referee, but you don't get that in Scotland with those decisions being made. Is that something the SFA is actively stopping, or is that just something...
It's not something we're actively stopping. It's more something that we've not started yet. I think it's worth remembering VAR has been in place in England for 7 years now. They are having problems with it from a decision point of view. Arguably this season they've had more problems than anybody, certainly a lot more than we've had. So we're on the journey in terms of VAR and the journey in terms of transparency, understanding, you know, efficiency of decision making and all those things. So it's something that's under review, but we're just not quite there yet in terms of the journey that Scottish football's on, because it's a big step to take. You know, I can understand why England have done it, but as I said, they've been doing it for a lot longer and the match officials are more experienced, and it's something that we'll continue to monitor.
Okay. Turning to regulation, the University of Edinburgh, I'm sure you know, have carried out research. In the research, only 12.9% of supporters believe the SFA does a good job for the Scottish game, and 11.1% of supporters believe that the current governance structure in the Scottish game is sustainable. How would you respond to those figures?
Anybody in any sort of governance role knows it's difficult. Everybody has an opinion, everybody can do it better, everybody thinks it should be different. From a Scottish FA perspective, we think the governance within the game is robust. It's an interesting statistic you point out. We do statistics based on a UEFA study. That talks about the fact that there is a real, I suppose, misunderstanding about what the Scottish Football Association does as an organisation. And of those people who do understand what the organisation does, those who feel that we're doing a good job, the proportion is something like 80%. So there is an educational piece for us to understand, to make sure that the football supporter knows what we do as an association, knows what we're about, knows the difference that we make to communities.
How long has the SFA been around?
we've been 150 years, you were at the anniversary.
Indeed. So in 150 years, the SFA hasn't let people know what its function is.
We've let people know what its function is. I think there is a general... Football fans concentrate on their team. They concentrate on what's happening on the pitch. There's less awareness and less desire to understand what a football association does. There is a narrative that's been on the go for since football began, you know, that referees are getting decisions wrong, all the things that we all talk about on a regular basis. From a football association perspective, we want to talk about the good work that we do, the huge amount of work that our clubs do, the impact that we have on communities, the way that football can save lives and transform lives. That's the message that we need to spread as an association, and that's where I think it would be great to talk about that today and how we can help the committee and the government.
Absolutely. I think my colleagues will certainly be coming on to those topics. We recently saw a very sad case in England with one of the Luton players having a cardiac event on the pitch, and this has been something that we have seen multiple occasions. What does the SFA have in place to ensure that we can try to prevent these things from happening, but also to reassure people that if something were to happen up here in Scotland, we have robust processes?
Yeah, SPFL players have a cardiogram. I can't remember the technical term. I can find out and I can write back to you on it. But there's medical checks that are done on players when they're signed on I think it's a three-yearly basis to check for any heart irregularities or anything like that. Obviously, players undergo very strict medicals when they sign for any football club. So let me take that away and I'll come back to you with the detail on what provisions we have in place. But there are obviously medical checks that are done from a health perspective to make sure the players are fit.
Thank you. No, we really appreciate getting that. My final question is around independent regulation. A massive 96.2% of people felt that independent regulation would be a positive step for Scottish football. And there are other figures which are just up in the 90s, you know, and that's overwhelming for supporters to be saying, because you're right, everyone does concentrate on their club. So why should we not be looking at implementing independent regulation from your point of view?
Yeah, I mean, the independent regulator, obviously, has a lot of profile down south. That was born off the back of four different incidents. One was the potential breakaway for the European Super League and the fact that English Premiership clubs were being courted for that. One was the financial failings at clubs down south who'd gone into administration, you know, Bury, Derby, Macclesfield Town. There had been a number of clubs that faced issues. There was the impact on football clubs that COVID had had and their ability to withstand that financial pressure, given the extreme financial pressures that football was under generally. And there was the changes that club owners had made in terms of, when you look at Hull, when you look at Cardiff City, they had changed club badges, changed club colours and made decisions that they hadn't engaged with their supporters on. So none of those elements are relevant for Scotland. In terms of the independent regulator piece, Scotland is very often... It's difficult because geographically we are next to the biggest footballing superpower in the world, being the English Premier League, and people think because something happens in England it should happen in Scotland, but they only think that because we're next door. There's no requirement. When you look at those four issues that I just outlined, we've had nothing like any of those issues in Scotland. The governance procedures that we've got are robust. Everybody, as I said, everybody has a different view. Everybody thinks it could be better. Everybody in any sort of governance role knows how difficult governing in any way, shape or form is. The review that took place in England was led by an independent MP. There was engagement with every single stakeholder within English football. There was 1,000 hours of evidence held. It was a really thorough, robust approach. The final review that was published in Scotland was written by one of the supporters' association who didn't even engage with the other supporters' association in Scotland, and it was very much the view of a couple of individuals about what they thought was appropriate for Scottish football. We don't see that. I think the fact that the independent regulator piece has had such little coverage, there's been such little clamour, there's been such little interest in the media, tells you that actually the processes that we've got in Scotland, whilst we can always improve and we're always looking to improve, they're fit for purpose.
Okay, thank you.
Okay. And before I move on to my colleague, Jillie Mackay, can Sandish Gulhani touched on VAR. How many female officials are there, VAR female officials?
I can double check that and come back to you. I'm not sure. I don't think we've got any female category one referees in Scotland at this point in time. It's definitely a key area for us, obviously, with the growth and development of the women's game. We want to see more female players playing, and we want to see more female coaches and more female referees.
Yeah, we'll come on to some of that
yeah, okay,
later on as we develop themes. Gillian Mackay.
Thanks, Convener. Project Brave was implemented around 6 years ago, refreshing a strategy outlined prior to that. Does the SFA plan to undertake an evaluation of the successes, failures and perceptions surrounding Project Brave?
It's constantly been evaluated. I think we should stop talking about Project Brave. That was a project at a specific time. You know, that was the name given for the changes that were made to the youth development system. It's now Club Academy Scotland. It's now the Player Development Pathway. It's constantly being assessed. It's constantly being changed. It's constantly being tweaked. You know, player development is obviously a key area for the Scottish FA because we want better Scottish players, or the Scottish players that we're developing, to be as good as they can be, and also clubs want to see them developing the best players as possible. So it's always something that's under review.
What work is being done to support smaller teams to ensure they can nurture local talent and give young people a positive place to play? I raise this because through Project Brave we saw some smaller clubs decide to scrap their youth systems altogether because of some of the criteria behind it. Livingston, Greenock Morton were just two of them in the last sort of few years. So what's being done to ensure that those clubs get the support that they need?
So the Club Academy Scotland programme is tiered to allow every club in Scotland to find their place within that landscape. So we have an elite tier when it goes right down to advanced youth and community. Livingston, interestingly, are now part of Club Academy Scotland. Again, it's a club decision to make whether they see youth development as a key priority for them or whether they don't. You know, it's not something for us to force clubs to develop players. The club needs to want to do it and have the resources available to do it. But the Club Academy structure allows clubs at every level the ability to find their place in the Club Academy landscape.
Who makes the decision on where those clubs come into within that structure?
That would be for the club to decide. The club could determine which level they would want to apply for, and that they would go through the process with us. There is no reason to think that, provided that obviously they meet the criteria, that they wouldn't be accepted into whichever level they wanted to be in. They wanted to enter it.
That's great. Thanks, Camina.
We're going to move to Tess White, who's joining us remotely.
Thank you, Convener. In relation to youths and child players, do JD performance schools effectively prepare children for a life outside football, and should they be released from their academies?
JD performance, well, obviously the kids are still being educated as part of their school experience. It's effectively their standard school experience, but there's football aligned to that, and they get more opportunity to participate in football and enhance their footballing ability. So it's not a question of do JDE prepare them for life after that. They are being prepared for it because they're going through a standard school curriculum alongside any other child.
Okay, thank you. And in relation to mental health, can you outline what support systems are in place to safeguard their mental health and wellbeing?
Yeah, our child wellbeing and protection team engage regularly with the kids who participate in the JD performance schools. Obviously, when they go back to their clubs, there are child wellbeing and protection officers at their clubs that they can engage with. All clubs that are in membership of the Scottish FA have a designated child wellbeing and protection officer. I can come back to you with some further detail on exactly what provisions are in place, but mental health is obviously something that we're very aware is a real challenge across society at the moment, and you know, we're doing as much as we can to help kids, help players, help anybody within the football family that needs such support.
Thank you. I'm aware that SPFL Trust run mental health training for all SPFL clubs, but there is a view that more needs to be done. In terms of monitoring, how many people a year go through that mental health training?
Not sure. It's an SPFL Trust programme, so I can find out the detail for that. Listen, mental health, as you said, being aware of mental health and being able to provide support is absolutely a concern. I don't think anybody's doing enough in that space, you know, and that's not specific to football, that's specific to society. It's such a big issue now that we all need to work together to make improvements and help those that need it in that area.
Thank you. But I suppose performance is really important. It's a high priority, but 99% of players don't make it as professionals. My question is, what evidence is there that the SFA's 2019 wellbeing and protection strategy has been a success and that children's safety and wellbeing is actually being prioritised?
Yeah, we recently commissioned the Children's Parliament to undertake a study of participants in youth football. The results of that were overwhelmingly positive. I'll send you on a copy, but it was over 90% of those playing football feel better when they're doing it, enjoy being part of a team, you know, like the feeling that being part of a team and the physical exercise that football gives them. There are a number of statistics that come out that show that the strategy is working and the projects that we've got in place are taking effect. Obviously, it's an ongoing area and we will never be finished working in the area of child protection and child wellbeing. And as I said, I'll forward more information in due course.
That's great. My final question, if I may, is evidence shows that child health and safety is at risk in grassroots football environment. And it's been like that for a long time, ever since football has started. But what new approaches is the SFA exploring and you're exploring to eradicate bullying and shouting culture that children can be exposed to from coaches and parents?
Yeah, it's a great question. As part of the Children's Parliament study, the participants were asked, do they feel safe playing football? The interesting part of that was the overwhelming results were round about fear of injury as opposed to fear of safety, as we would determine it, as in terms of the way that you've just framed it. They were more concerned about being injured than they were about anything else. They feel safe, they feel they've got a trusted adult in their coaching staff that they know that they can speak to. So, yeah, that's... what was the second part of your question there, Tess? Sorry, just remind me.
Well, it was almost about shouting. And I just quote, when you say it's more about injury, from a survey that we've got, it's as high as 23% of the respondents worry about adults shouting at them and, you know, children crying. And there is a view, and there's a quote from that survey that says nobody checks on the adults.
Yeah, sorry, I forgot the second part. That's a very good point. That you're absolutely right. The survey that we did, one of the main pieces of feedback was that the kids love playing football. They hate when their parents shout at them. They hate when their parents shout at the referee. They hate when the parents shout at each other. We have an ongoing piece of work through the affiliated national associations that we have, so the Scottish Youth Football Association, Scottish Women's Football and the Scottish Amateur Association, to understand how we impact that parental behaviour piece, because it's a challenge absolutely in Scotland. It's actually a challenge across the world, and again through IFAB, one of the main areas of focus for that body for the next 12 months is going to be to produce a plan that helps football deal with those cultural issues, because they are a big challenge. Anybody that's been on the side of a youth game in the recent history will know that the atmosphere can become very toxic very quickly. And what we're trying to encourage young people to play football and enjoy themselves, so it's not the right setting. Given the scope and scale of football, it's a big area for us. It's a difficult problem to solve, but there's absolutely a willingness to do that, and we're working with the affiliated associations to understand how best we can impact that, because it's something that we need to deal with.
A comment, and I do know what it's like on the standing on the football pitch and people shouting. Is there any consequence management? Do you follow up with people who just constantly bully and shout?
That would happen through the affiliated association, so the SYFA or SWF would get involved at that point. It's not as stringent as it could be. The difficulty in all of these is football happens in public parks, so you don't know at the side of the pitch if it's a parent, if it's a carer, if it's someone that's watching the game. So understanding that landscape is important as well, to let us formalise plans and how we deal with those types of behaviour, because it's something that we really want to eradicate from football.
Thank you. Thank you, convener.
Thanks, Tess. So in April 2017, previous session, parliamentary session, the then Health and Sport Committee undertook an inquiry into child protection in sport. I was part of the committee at that point in time, and we had evidence sessions from the SFA and Scottish Youth Football Association. That was quite a critical report particularly of the SFA, and I think, and I'm quoting here from it, that we consider the SFA has been asleep on the job and continually complacent in this area in terms of child protection and looking after children's welfare. So can you tell us how the relationship between the SFA and the SYFA has progressed since 2017? When dealing with children's wellbeing and protection, and has the SFA adopted a more hands-on approach?
Absolutely. The relationship's grown immeasurably, and obviously I came into post in 2018, so I can only talk about then. We've got very stringent protocols in place in terms of checks that coaches must do in terms of not only coaching qualifications, but obviously also in the PVG space. You know, coaches need to be PVG'd before they can take part in any coaching at all. That was from my understanding, my recollection was that was a big part of the problem in 2017, that the PVG operation wasn't being handled appropriately. So that is absolutely part of that. That's all monitored via the football administration system that we have, so we can check coaches are appropriately checked. There's ongoing communication with the SYFA, SWF, all the other constituent parts of football that will have children playing for them. The Scottish FA issued a board directive in 2016, which requires affiliate national associations to comply with four or five different pieces of criteria around about all the checks and balances that we need to see in place. There have been... there's ongoing dialogue. I mean, we sit on a non-professional game board that meets every quarter. Obviously, the SYFA are along the corridor in Hampden, and there's regular dialogue between our child wellbeing and protection leads and the individual child wellbeing and protection leads at each of the affiliate national associations. So there's been a huge shift. There are a significant number of people in Scottish football now working full-time from a child wellbeing and protection space to make sure that the processes are correct across the game.
So have board members of the SFA completed child protection training?
Yes.
All of them?
Yes.
And for the Scottish Youth Football Association as well? Because that was certainly an issue that came up previously that they hadn't.
I can only talk about the Scottish FA board. I know that we have, and we do it on a regular basis. I can come back to you on the SYFA.
I think that would be really helpful to know. One of the other issues that had been raised, and had been raised by a previous Children's Commissioner as well, was about children, particularly boys, signing for clubs as on... schoolboy forms, whatever, and the impact that then had on the children in terms of being able to then play for other clubs. Can you update the committee on where the SFA is with that particular issue?
The registration point that I remember, I'm not aware of that, the circumstances that you outlined there. I think that, again, that predates me, and I've not heard anything from any constituent para football that says that's a problem. I'm not aware of any of that. The couple of matters that we were dealing with at the time were around about FIFA training compensation, when that was due, and we've changed our rules and regulations to ensure that that's only due at the point that the player signs his first professional contract, which is in line with FIFA regulations and in line with the recommendation of the committee. There was a question around registration periods, and there was a 30-month registration period that effectively the club was in control of. From a youth player's perspective, that's now been changed, and starting next summer, it's changed recently because we've changed from a summer season to a more traditional season, which is a bit of a technicality. But now players in the elite level of Club Academy Scotland from 15 and up will sign a 2-year registration, which will be agreed between the player, between the player's parents and between the club. So there's a much more joined up approach to that. It's not that the club unilaterally can control that player's registration. It's obviously an agreement that the player and the parents and the club sign at the same time, which again is an improvement in terms of the position that the committee held last time.
Okay, that's really helpful to get that update. And just as a wee follow up to the question that I'd asked on VAR, you said there was no Cat 1 female referees. Are there any Cat 2 female referees?
I would need to check.
Okay, if you could do that, that'd be really helpful.
Yep.
Ruth Maguire.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning, Ian. Thanks for being with us. I'd like to ask you about fan representation and voice, and then accessibility of matches. Gate receipts represent 43% of total football income in Scotland. My understanding is that's quite unusual amongst UEFA, and it's the highest.
Yep.
The Scottish Football Alliance believes that supporters' voices and fan representation and decision making doesn't reflect just how crucial supporters are to the survival of our game. Mm-hmm. Would the SFA be open to including a fan representative on the board?
Fan representation is obviously important across the game. You know, fans want to be heard, fans should be heard at clubs. There are varying governance models within clubs. Some are fully supporter owned and supporter run. Some have got a hybrid model that's got a board and some supporter engagement, and some aren't quite there yet. I mean, it's ultimately for a club.
So, yeah, let me be clear. I appreciate the different structures within the clubs in Scotland. I'm asking about the SFA board specifically. Would the SFA be open to having fan representation on the board?
So our board structure at the moment is two representatives from the professional game, one from the non-professional game, three office bearers, and we've got two independent non-execs. So I would argue the independent non-execs are football supporters. They obviously have an involvement in football and an engagement with football and want to be part of the board structure. So I would argue we have, you know, an element of supporter engagement on the board.
Okay. Further to that, the Scottish Football Alliance recommends that Scottish football season ticket holders be allowed to vote for the president of the SFA. And they argue, and forgive me, I'm going to quote them directly, they argue that this would replace antiquated and undemocratic process of procession to office and blazer procession with a fair voting structure. How would you respond to that?
This is a suit jacket, not a blazer. The president is elected by the membership of the association, and that feels like a fairly standard, fairly structured operational process that the members of an organisation would then elect who the president and the vice president are. There are opportunities for fan-owned clubs to put forward a representative of their club for the position of president. That position can come from across the football family and can be put forward by any of the membership. So it feels like, from a structural perspective, the membership determining who the president and the vice president are feels like that makes sense.
Do you think, I mean, and that's slightly pejorative language aside, and it's a very nice suit jacket. Could you see the benefit, though, in opening it up? You know, when we think about trust and that value of supporters and trust in the SFA, that opening that up to making it more democratic could be beneficial for the game.
There needs to be an understanding of football, though. You know, I think that has to be the case, that anybody coming in as a president or the vice president of a football association would need to have some sort of understanding of football, and there's no better place for that to come from than from the membership. I mean, you've got 120...
That's not how democracy works. Everyone gets a vote and they decide who's going to represent them. There's not a test, you know.
So I don't get the point.
What they're suggesting is that all season ticket holders can vote for the president. So I would assume, I don't know the details of how those elections would be tabled, but presumably qualified individuals with experience would put themselves forward, and then there would be some sort of voting process.
I think if you take a step back, my point is clubs have the opportunity to put forward whoever they want. So season ticket holders at a club could take that decision to put forward someone from their club. So they would be effectively having a say in that, rather than because listen, trying to get Scottish football as a whole to agree on anything is an impossible task.
We manage elections in other contexts, so I don't think it would be beyond the Scottish public to vote for the president. But I hear what you're saying. But in principle, would you not be for more fan involvement?
Fan involvement is key in football. Absolutely. You know, I was at a club that was very engaged with supporters. Football fans obviously want a voice. They want to be heard within their club structure. They want a voice in how their club's run and the operation of that. We need to be careful as well, because fans are very emotional. They're fanatics by definition, and you know, supporters make emotional decisions when running football clubs. But they need to have a voice. They need to be able to be heard and be understood, and that's absolutely right that they're given that opportunity.
I wonder, I don't think it's necessarily that fans want to run the SFA. I think it's maybe that they want more accountability and they want a say in who that executive is. Mm-hmm. Could you see the benefit of that?
I think I've set out the position, you know, clubs have the opportunity, fans have the opportunity through their clubs to put forward whoever they feel would make the most sense from a club perspective. You know, we've got a structure that's voted on by the membership. It's been in place for a considerable time.
Okay, moving on. Given Viaplay's recent announcement that it's going to end its involvement in UK sport coverage in early 2024, how realistic is it to expect that the SFA will take the opportunity to make future TV coverage of the men's national team free to air?
Well, the nuance to it is Viaplay are under contract with UEFA until 2028 for men's national team rights. That's not changed. We've not heard that's not going to be the broadcaster from that point. I understand that Viaplay are going through a process and are potentially looking to offload some of their rights. I think I would frame the question differently. I don't think it's on the SFA to make sure that the games are free to air. I think it's on the free to air broadcasters to make sure the games are free to air. The process is that anybody can bid for our national team rights. We don't control. We don't have any. It's centralised through UEFA. It is open for anybody to come and bid for them. Ultimately, it comes down to value. It comes down to finance. We receive money from the UEFA centralised deal. We then use that money to go and do the good work that we do across the country. As long as those financial terms are met, anybody can show our games. I would love the games to be on free tier, but it ultimately comes down to the free tier broadcasters and can they commit the required finance. So again, that's another conversation for the committee to say how do we make sure that that happens, because it would be great for us, it would be great for the game.
I suppose the first point I would make is that it would be down to me how to frame questions, and you can answer them in whatever way you wish. Are there other revenues or other avenues of revenue that the SFA could explore to make up that funding?
We are constantly looking at avenues of additional revenue. I mean, ultimately, the vast majority of the income that we bring in goes back out either to the clubs or goes back out to do, the excellent work that we do across the community as Scottish football, and that's as an association and that's also as clubs. We want to drive that as much as we can. We fully appreciate that, you know, later on today we're going to have what's been widely regarded as the most difficult budget since devolution. There are going to be cuts included in that, but we should be talking about sport and the ability that sport has to go and transform lives and make a really significant impact across the country. So anything that would diminish our ability to do that doesn't make sense from an association perspective. And we're absolutely, you know, focused on driving additional revenue to make sure that we can go and continue to do the good work that we're doing.
Okay. And acknowledging that there are sort of wider things involved, what can the SFA do to help ensure that our team, you know, our national team sport is free to view? I suppose it's about, you know, I can afford to go to football games. Not everyone can. You know, we talk about the benefits of sport. Everyone around this table absolutely understands the benefit of sports. And part of that is watching it and being part of it. You know, what can the SFA specifically do to help ensure that that's accessible and free to, I suppose, particularly young boys and girls that are wanting to watch their national team?
We are engaging on a regular basis with, you know, particularly BBC. They've got the Scottish Cup rights at the moment. The Scottish Cup rights for future years will be going out for offers soon, and we're engaging with them to make sure that they're across that and can do as much as they can to make sure they secure as many of those games as possible. And the same from a UEFA perspective. The challenge is that the international rights, as with all 55 national associations under UEFA, are centralised through their process, and it's for BBC to have a conversation with UEFA about how that looks. We can be involved in those discussions, but ultimately, under the terms of the agreement, it will be UEFA that decide what that looks like. But again, as I said, it's for any free-tier broadcaster to go and have a conversation with UEFA, and providing the value is right, there is no reason why the matches can't be on free-tier going forward.
OK, thank you.
Sandra Kohani.
Thank you. And certainly one of the things that you've said repeatedly is how sport can change lives. And I completely agree with you.
Yeah.
I think there's been a bit of focus on men's football right now, so I want to turn to women's football. It's a huge growth market. It's a huge growth game. Over half our population are women and want to be involved in it, or potentially be involved in it. So what are the SFA doing to not only promote the women's game, but to make it more robust and to make it something where we could then get more money in to then continue its growth?
Yeah, it's absolutely a key area for us. We have 22,000 registered female players across the country, which is the highest number we've ever had. That continues to grow. Clubs are committing more and more resource to their women's teams, both at an elite professional level and also at a grassroots level. There are more women's recreational teams popping up across the country on a regular basis. There's a real demand for that. The challenge that we have is from a facilities perspective, because if you think about the growth of the game, we've got 160,000 registered players. We think there's close to 1 million people engaged in football, whether that's playing it recreationally from a grassroots perspective, whether that's volunteering at clubs, coaching at clubs, dropping the kids off at the weekend. There's a huge amount of the population engages in football. While we're seeing a growth in participation numbers, we're seeing a decrease in facilities, and those two things don't make sense. You know, we are finding that more and more girls and women want to play football. The let they can get is 9 o'clock on a Friday night, because that's all that's available, because historically lets have been taken up by other parts of the game. So there is a real drive from an association perspective in terms of what can we do to improve the facilities, to increase the facility provision round the country. That's something that I would love to spend some time talking to the committee about the impact that we can have, about the impact that football has, and the impact that sport can have, because, you know, particularly recently, every time you pick up a newspaper, it's talking about potential swimming pool closures, you know, hockey pitches that they can't get access to. How do we provide solutions for government? As I said, we've got a really difficult budget coming. There are going to be pressure, there's financial pressure across the board. In times like that, we need to make sure that the money that we are spending is being spent as efficiently and as effectively as possible. Sport can play a huge part from a preventative perspective in terms of healthcare spend, that we're focusing on dealing with people when they're unwell and when they've got diabetes and when they've got heart issues. Actually, what can we do to spend preventatively to get people active as early as possible, which then stops this amount of money being needed to spend up here, because the return on investment you'll get from investing at the front end is hugely disproportionate in terms of what the outcome would be.
Certainly, I agree with all of that. But if it's not come across from other members, it'd be great if you could write to us with specific things that you're doing to grow the women's game.
Yeah,
that'd be fantastic.
Yeah, absolutely.
Thank you.
Kelly.
Thanks very much, Convener. Just to piggyback off one of Ruth Maguire's questions, given the large take for the SFA from tickets, do you believe that greater consideration should be given to fan voice over broadcaster demands, particularly on issues such as fixture scheduling that we've seen issues with in recent years?
What do you mean, given the take?
Given the amount that supporters spend on yeah. tickets and, yeah. and going to matches and things,
yeah.
shouldn't their wants from and their convenience in yeah. scheduling of matches be given priority over broadcaster demands? We've seen the issues with people getting to and from matches because of matches being changed because of broadcaster yeah. demands.
Unfortunately, that's the reality that we live in. When you look at sport across the world now, it's changed. You know, traditional kickoff times are no longer a thing. You look at the NFL, they've recently agreed to take 8 NFL matches outside of America and play them in other parts of the world. So there's a traditional element to this, and I can understand the question, but the reality is football and sport is completely different. There is a huge amount of money that comes into the game from broadcasters.
But don't you think it's a basic level of respect for fans to actually go, yes, you can make it to that game by public transport, or it's not an inconvenient time, or we've not suddenly changed the time
yeah.
because of a broadcaster demand negatively impacting fans. Fans are not going to return to games if they don't feel that they're respected by the SFA too. So when we're talking about funding and that the take is so high from ticket sales, shouldn't it be a basic principle that fans are respected in these decisions?
Ultimately, we have to find a balance, because there's
So is that a no?
No, it's not a no. There's a significant revenue that comes in from ticket sales on matches. There's also a bigger revenue that comes in from broadcasters. As I said, that income comes into the Scottish Football Association and goes out to help do the good that we do across the country. We want to keep driving that. In terms of national team matches under UEFA, they have a week of football, so they will tell us effectively when the games are. We don't have any say in when those games are scheduled. As I said, the traditional 3 o'clock on a Saturday kickoff at that elite level of football doesn't happen on a regular basis. You look at the English Premier League, have just announced a £6.7 billion TV deal with 1,000 more games that are going to be shown. They're going to be shown at all times of the day and night. Some will be shown together, some will be shown on their own. That is just the world that we live in. You know, the way people consume sport, particularly from a younger audience perspective, that people aren't interested in sitting down at 3 o'clock on a Saturday and watching a game now. The world has changed. The
then why should the broadcasters be prioritised then? If people are consuming it in different ways, why should the fans who are going not be the ones that are prioritised rather than the ones who are watching it online if people can watch it on catch-up and in various other ways?
Because it's about finding the
because
balance,
it's about
ultimately.
Money.
It's about finding the balance. That's the reality. It's finding the balance, as I said, between people that want to come and watch football, and as one of your colleagues touched on, we've got the highest number of supporters going through the turnstiles per capita across Europe on a regular basis, and that's a big, big part of Scottish football. But there is also the broadcast element and the partnership element that we need to be cognisant of, because it drives significant revenue into the games, which lets clubs go and do the good work that they do across communities and to help improve lives. So we need to find the balance of all of those things together.
OK, thanks, Camina.
So, pick up on Gillian Mackay's question in there. So was it income from broadcasters that led to the decision to change the time of the Scottish Cup final?
It was. There was a broadcast element to that, and there was also the fact that the FA Cup was scheduled to be at the same time, and so was the Women's Champions League. So, and there was communication that went back and forward on that. It's a showpiece event. We wanted to give it its own space. We wanted to have it at a point where people across the UK could sit down and watch it on their own and not be distracted by other events. Like I said, you know, we wrote to you at the time. There was a bit of communication going back and forward. So
there certainly was, and there was certainly a lot of disquiet from the fans that Gillian Mackay has been referencing there. So there was an element of income from broadcasters and that influenced that decision. Is that what you're saying?
There are a number of factors that go into a kick-off time. Broadcaster preference is one.
I'm looking for a simple yes or no here. Was income from broadcasters one of the drivers?
It's part of a decision, yeah.
Okay. We're going to move to Tess White.
Thank you, Convener. Just one final question. We recently conducted an extensive inquiry into female participation in sport and physical activity. My question is, have you reviewed that report and discussed it with your board?
The report has been reviewed by the senior team at the Scottish FA. It's not got to the board yet. But listen, female participation, the growth in female participation is absolutely key and fundamental to everything that we're trying to do as an association. Driving the female game forward, as one of your colleagues touched on, it's such a huge growth area. It makes such a difference to individuals. It's absolutely right that we're doing as much as we can in that space.
Right, sorry, that doesn't answer my... It partly answers my question, which is that inquiry, and football was part of it. It wasn't... Because football is so important in Scotland, actually building on that work, the reason I mention it is just to ask you if you can be a champion for the findings from that inquiry so that it just doesn't get left on a shelf. Thank you.
Carol Morgan.
Thank you, Convener. I'm interested really in some of the points that you have made around this balance of grassroots community sport, football as part of that, and yep. Then obviously the sort of national team and the drive to get quality in that national team. So first of all, in terms of community space, I know from what we've read that you do have an influence and you meet with stakeholders. I'm just wondering where you think it is at the moment in terms of having good quality space for people just to play ordinary games of football?
In simple terms, we don't have enough.
Okay.
As I touched on, you know, the increase in participants has been significant. The decline in facilities has been significant. There has been very little finance that's gone into upgrading, relaying football pitches, even thinking about pavilions and space for particularly the girls and women who want to come and play games. You know, football changing areas aren't adequate for that anymore. We are very focused as an association on what we can do to drive that. We got some funding through the UK government's Levelling Up Fund. We got some funding through DCMS. There's £18 million that we've had. By the end of 24, we'll have distributed all of that through partner funding. We'll have turned that into more or less double, and we're using that money to improve and develop facilities across the country. That has to be a key area for government, for everybody on the committee, to make sure that we're continuing to do that, because as I said, from a preventative spend perspective, we've got undeniable facts that point to the fact, you know, Spartans as an example, let's take Spartans because we're in Edinburgh, they've got 1,700 footballers within their club. They produce a healthcare benefit of £1.8 million over the lifetime of those footballers, because we are reducing diabetes, because we're reducing heart disease, because we're helping with obesity, we're helping impact on mental health issues. There's the social benefits that come from a reduction in crime because of diversion activity that happens. There's the economic value by people just paying for pitchlets and buying petrol to get to and from training. So the economic impact that grassroots football has in the country is worth over €1.2 billion on an annual basis. That's huge. €700 million of that is, and it's euros because it's a UEFA study, €700 million of that is benefits to the health service. So that goes back to my earlier point. There is absolutely no doubt that investment in sport and investment in football, because we're the biggest sport in the country by a distance, will absolutely positively impact on the health and well-being of the vast majority of individuals across the country. And how do we, as football and as sport, help the government, help you guys make that happen and bring that to life? Because things are tough, finances are tight across the board for everybody, and as I said, we need to make sure that we're maximising revenue that we're spending and making sure that we're getting as much out of that as we possibly can. And there is no doubt that football can play a huge part in that, and we are here to try and help. We want to be the vehicle to see those improvements and see those changes across the country, because it's so important.
I suppose from what you're saying is, do you have a strategy to try and work with stakeholders? I mean, I think everybody here would agree with the points that you're making about having those facilities is so important for preventative health.
Yeah.
But have you started to pull together a strategy? Who might be able to work together to improve some of these grassroots?
Yeah, we're pulling that together at the moment. So historically, it's always been a local authority issue, pretty much, to look at facilities. We've concerned ourselves with getting participants on the pitch, and it's been up to others over the years through cashback programmes and things like that to worry about facilities. Obviously, the landscape's changed, so we've taken more of an onus as an association to say, well, actually, whilst there's a multi-stakeholder, it's a multi-stakeholder problem, football needs to play its part in trying to be the solution. So what can we do as a business? So as an example, every penny that we make from the Euros in 2024 will go into a facilities fund that will help put facilities across the country. So we are very committed to doing as much as we can. Unfortunately, that won't touch the sides. Okay. There needs to be much more involvement, much more engagement. We've been speaking to Scottish Government. I've got a meeting tomorrow with Michael Matheson, Marie Todd, to talk about a long-term strategic partnership that tries to pull all these different strands of the benefits that sport can bring together and do it in a long-term, sustainable way, rather than the kind of piecemeal, annual, year-on-year process that we have at the moment. So we're doing as much as we can. As an association, we need to think about how we get generate investment into the game. Part of that investment needs to come from government, from local authorities, and whatever that looks like. I get the challenges around about the finance, but given we can prove that as I said, the bang for your buck that you'll get from investing in football is so significant, it's not something that we can ignore, and we need to keep pushing and driving. And any support that the committee can give, any support that individuals around the table can give to help us do that and plug us into the right departments within government or external funders that would be happy to see investment into facilities going back into local communities, and that would be very welcome.
I appreciate the sort of drive you've put towards that, and hopefully we as a committee will get a chance to find out what developments there are, particularly if you are working with the government on that. Just in terms of time, I'll move on to the sort of national team side of things, if you like. I know that we've had some papers saying that there is a hope to develop a very top-end training complex. I just wondered how far you were ahead with that, and given some of the discussions we've had, is that very much looking at all, the men's game, the women's game, and who would be able to use that facility?
Yeah. You'll be referring to comments that Steve Clark made about a training facility, and that's very much something that we're looking at. Facilities are a problem at every level of football, whether it's at the elite end of the game or down in the grassroots game. So it's an ongoing piece of work to understand the facilities issues across the country. But our priority at this point in time is facilities for the grassroots game, because without that, we don't have enough places for the people that want to play football to play. And you can extend that to sport more generally, and that's going to have a negative impact on the country, and that has to be our focus.
That's very helpful. Thank you.
Emma Harper.
Thanks, Convener. Good morning, Ian.
You
talked a little bit about growing the game for women,
yeah.
And you've taken a couple of questions already. And so I'm interested in how do we support growing the game, especially dealing with sexism? And in the report that we've got a link to, it's the Children's Parliament report for the Scottish Football Association titled Getting It Right for Every Child in Football. And one of the quotes is from a girl. She says, as a girl playing in what is seen as a boy's sport, it can be really hard and lots of sexism still exists, especially from parents. And there's another quote that says, there's a lot of sexism from boys towards girls playing football, making me not want to participate in school PE classes and games, as I've been purposely targeted by boys and hurt because they don't think girls should play. So my question is, what is the Scottish Football Association doing to tackle sexism in football?
It's a good point. It's not perfect. I'm not going to sit here and say that it is, but we are working hard. You know, there's a real educational piece that's required across the game. When you talk about, you know, a young child saying that they're unhappy with those kind of comments coming from a parent is unacceptable. There's an educational piece that we are doing with the participants particularly, because we've got more control over them that because of the club environments that they're in, and we can engage with them on a more regular basis to make them understand what is right and wrong. A lot of what happens at football matches is kind of manifests itself as game, but it's actually societal problems when you think about unacceptable conduct and things that happen at matches that nobody wants to see. A lot of that are societal issues that tend to show up at football matches. So there's an educational piece for a wider group. It's not necessarily a football problem on its own to fix, but we obviously have programmes, you know, Show Racism the Red Card as an example. We'll go into all our clubs and deliver programmes and deliver training to players across the game. We are working with numerous partners to make sure that there's an educational piece that helps participants particularly understand what's right and what's wrong. There is a, I get alongside that, there is a parental piece, and how we educate them, as I touched on earlier, is a far bigger challenge, but something that we're committed to trying to impact.
Okay, and under the wider inclusivity, I've written a couple of notes that talks about sex and sexism, disability and discrimination, race and racism, and rurality and exclusion. Yeah. So is there further work that needs to be done for wider inclusivity before I come on to sectarianism?
Inclusivity is a big driver for us. You know, we were the first national association in the world to implement a para-football association, which takes all versions of para-football and gives anybody in the country, regardless of the challenges that they face, the opportunity to take part in the game. So that includes wheelchair, power chair football, amputee football. There's a mental health league. You know, we are broadening the game out as far as we possibly can to make sure that anybody that wants to play can play, because inclusivity is obviously a big driver for us, and it's the national sport and we want as many people as possible to play. So there's a para ENA that meet on a regular basis, and they're driving forward opportunities in those specific areas for people that can't play traditional football, in inverted commas. So that's very much a focus for us.
Okay, and then my final question, conveners, about sectarianism in our papers. It talks about bigotry, sectarianism and racism remain key issues in Scottish football, often fuelled by footballing rivalries. Some of the figures were quoted were 89% of supporters witnessed and 41% were subjected to sectarianism, and 56% of supporters witnessed and 4% were subjected to racism. So racism seems to be reduced in percentages compared to sectarianism. So what is being done to look at issues of sectarianism in Scottish football?
Again, that's part of our wider work. So I touched on Show Racism the Red Card. We have a Show Racism the Red Card day across the game, and when clubs will engage with their spectators, there'll be programme adverts, there'll be educational pieces and programmes to raise awareness around that issue. As I touched on, there are things that happen at football matches that are football matches become a microcosm of society. You know, what we're seeing is not specific to football. These incidents don't just happen at football games, they happen across wider society, and it's going to take a multi-stakeholder approach to try and impact all of these elements, because education is obviously key. As I touched on, clubs do a huge amount of work in terms of education and input into players, and, you know, telling them about racism, telling them about sectarianism, what's right and wrong in all those areas. there is a wider population piece that we need to understand how football plays its part in dealing with that, but can't do it on its own, unfortunately. It's a wider societal issue in Scotland that will take a lot more than football to fix, but we're happy to play a part in it.
And we obviously will be monitoring the numbers and the data to see these percentages of sectarianism and racism reduce.
Absolutely, that's got to be the aim, yeah.
Okay, thanks.
Can I just pick up a little bit on some of the questions that I'd asked of you earlier, Ian, particularly about female referees? So having looked through your website, every landing page that I go to, right down to Category 6 referees, it's a man. That's the first picture you see. When you go to the page Become a Referee, where you're obviously trying to recruit people, 3 out of 4 pictures are of males. I clicked onto the referee kit shop. All of the clothing appears to be male and male sizes. So how is the SFA using its website to actively promote female referees? If that's, as a woman, I go on and see that, that seems to me that, you know, women are not wanted.
Yeah. No, that's feedback I'll take back. We've had female referee only coaching courses. We've done a lot of work to try and encourage females in every aspect of football, whether it's to participate. We've had female-only coaching courses to try and encourage females to come and do that in a female-only environment, because the feedback that we had is that females are more inclined and more willing to go and participate in that if it's a female-only environment. So that, you know, we've done that from a coaching perspective and we've done it from a refereeing perspective. I'll take the feedback on the website and we can review that internally. But listen, female participation in football generally across every area is absolutely a key driver for us, because we see the opportunities there.
Sure, I appreciate that, certainly in terms of playing, but in terms of officiating, it seems to be, you know, that it's a male, it's for men only. Even clicking onto the Referees Association, which there's a link for, it's all men.
Yeah.
I would actively encourage you to go and have a look at your website. If indeed the SFA are trying to recruit more female officials. Sandesh Gohani, did you have a further supplementary on this?
Yes, just specifically about what the SFA are doing to increase diversity in refereeing. So certainly we've heard from the convener about female referees, but we sort of need to see wider society as well. So what specifically is the SFA doing to try to actively recruit people from diverse ethnic backgrounds?
Yeah, I can get back to you on the specifics, because there are programmes in place. Diversity is obviously key. When we talk about inclusivity, diversity is obviously a key part of that. We want the Scottish FA, Scottish football, to be representative of the communities and the society that within which we live. So it's a key area for us, it's a key opportunity for us. We want to get as much engagement as possible, and I can come right back to you with details from a diversity perspective in terms of our plans.
Thank you. And certainly, do you think that there is equivalent diversity throughout the SFA as well?
In terms of the organisation?
Yes.
We are on a journey from a diversity perspective. There's no doubt about that. It's something that we are working hard on. We have a number of HR plans in place. We have recently signed up for the Merkey programme. You'll not be aware of that, through Adidas, which looks at employing individuals from diverse backgrounds. And we'll continue to strive in that area.
Okay. If you could write to us about that as well. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Mr Maxwell. Our next meeting will be after the new year on the 16th of January, where we'll be taking evidence on the Scottish Budget for 2024-25 from the Cabinet Secretary for NHS Recovery, Health and Social Care. Can I take this opportunity to wish everyone a happy and restful festive period, and that concludes the public part of our meeting today.